Well, we have a thought-provoking show planned for you today. We'll take some calls. We'll tell you specifically what's going on in San Francisco. Very interesting. First, I'll tell you about LifeLock. Better Business Bureau is a warning for you guys. Posting your senior pictures, graduation date, high school name, it gives the scammers an opportunity to piece together your profile and then to hack you. It's important to understand how cybercrime is affecting our lives every day. We put our info out there, and it's all at risk because it's all on the internet. Cyber criminals keep finding new ways to steal identities. You could miss certain threats if you're only monitoring your credit. LifeLock is a leader in identity theft protection. If you become a victim of identity theft, LifeLock can help you restore your identity easier than if you were just on your own and didn't have LifeLock. They're the industry standard. 2020, protect yourself with LifeLock, right, Dawson?
No, to prevent all identity theft or monitor all transactions at all businesses. Join now and save up to 25% off your first year by using promo code Adam. Call 1-800-LIFELOCK or head to LifeLock.com. Use promo code Adam for 25% off. From Carolla One Studios and Gina's house and Brian's house, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, actor Theo Rossi. With Gina Grad on news, Bald Brian on sound effects, and Dave Dameshek's here for good sports. And now, reminding you it's okay to feel not okay. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice, baby. On any mandate, you get it on. Thanks for tuning in, y'all. We appreciate that. Good day, Gina Grad.
Good day to you.
And Bald Brian.
Don't care.
God, that had so much of the Wicked Witch of the East in it. The care. Play
my
it
Jay
again.
Cutler impression.
Yeah, think of the care at the end part of the word care.
Don't care.
Yeah. I'll get you, my pretty.
Yes.
I got a new role.
God, we got
wait for a house to drop on me.
Think about mashing up "Don't Care" and "I'll Get You, My Pretty" or whatever from the Wicked Witch of the. All right, so much to discuss. Something I did a few weeks, I taped it a few weeks ago, the Feed the Hungry telethon or whatever, the bit.
Oh, yeah.
We never really played my bit, which was, there's about 2 minutes, just bang on, just 2 minutes, Feeding America Comedy Festival. It aired last Sunday. And there's a funny, so here's an interesting twist or piece of trivia for you guys. There is a joke in this bit that is not really a laugh line type joke. It's not going to be set up punchline. It's a joke. And it's a subtle joke. And it's a little bit of a play on words. And I just put it in there because I thought it was funny. I never really explained it or landed on it, so you wouldn't really know it from listening. But somebody did tweet me that I got a tweet saying blankety blank, funniest line of the whole night.
Oh, wow.
And there's a lot of good comedy going on. And I thought one person got this joke.
If you can reach just one person.
Now, it's not the kind of joke where I would blame you if you didn't get it. It's weird and subtle, but, and Chris didn't get it, but I also little things to look for. And like, is this a joke or isn't it a joke? Well, why would you say it? Like, you might not need to say it. Mm-hmm. So if you did say it, there's probably a joke there somewhere, but I'll just play you the 2 minute bit. You guys can play along at home. Max Patty, you have that tweet the person sent me, and we can see, we can kind of figure out, see if we can get the joke. All right, here we go. Now, hold on. Don't tell me a joke that's an obvious joke. That much, we know what the jokes are. This will be a subtle one.
Hey, everybody. Adam Carolla here. This virus is affecting everyone negatively, but it's not all bad news. There's some good news. There's good news and bad news. I mean, bad news, you can't visit your elderly parents. Good news, I can't visit my elderly parents. I'm this close to convincing my mom that the virus can be passed through the phone. Bad news, the spelling bee was canceled. Good news, Now we all know how to spell hydroxychloroquine. Bad news, it's going to be a long time before you can see your favorite basketball team at an arena. Wait a minute. I just came up with an idea. Note to self, use t-shirt cannons to safely distribute medication to the elderly. Bad news, all my kids' sporting events have been canceled. Good news, all my kids' sporting events have been canceled. I know this quarantine is difficult for everyone, but it's important that we stay connected at this time. Heck, I've cultivated new and inspiring relationships, from the homeless guy who cuts my hair to my new friend on Twitter that says as soon as the quarantine is lifted, he's coming to my house to strangle me. It reminds me of a saying I learned when I was doing a little time in a Mexican prison outside of Cotonel Dos Playas. You can do the time, or the time can do you. We all have a short prison sentence to do. You want to come out with the next great American novel and six-pack abs, or do you want a face tattoo and a venereal disease? Take care of yourself, take care of your family, use this time to do things you never thought of doing. Make lasagna, build a doghouse, and especially donate to charities like this one.
All right. Well, now.
Well done.
Thank you. Now, the question, the hiding, the secret joke, the invisible joke.
I was playing pretty close attention. I didn't pick up on anything.
Was it the guy, the homeless guy who cuts your hair?
But what would the joke? I mean, what would the hiding joke be?
Yeah, I didn't even get it.
You have a new best friend, and he's on Twitter.
Again, if it's just a joke, it's a joke. But if it's got to be a hidden joke, somebody tweeted me this. I don't know. It was last night. Again, I was willing to just put it in there as my own little Easter egg.
Oh, double ply Cottonelle.
Yes, I was staying in a Mexican prison outside of Cottonelle Dos Playas, which
wow.
Made him laugh.
That's great. The gringo dummies, it went right past us.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm like, there must be a place called Cottonelle Dos Playas.
Sounds reasonable.
No, it sounds reasonable. What you have to think about is I would say Cottonelle Dos Playas. We should make that a town in Mexico.
That's really funny.
I'm going to, you know what? I'm not going to say to anyone I'm going to Cancun or Cozumel. I'm going to Cottonelle Dos Playas. And eventually everyone will start nodding their head. And then I'll go, yeah, I was out there with Jen Aniston. Me, Jen Aniston, and Jimmy, we had all this. Well, it's really two houses, but anyway.
Yeah.
I guess it's a lake. It's man-made. It's private, but I guess it's technically a lake.
The beach is public, but nobody really goes on except for Jen. And that's at Cottonelle Dos Playas out there. It's beautiful, beautiful. And then they go, like, and it's safe. It's safe. It's a two-ply town. It's a safe town.
Cushy.
It's a cushy town. It's a quilted town.
Gina.
It's quilted.
That's a great joke, and we're dummies for not picking up on that.
No, you're not. The only clue, as I said to Max Apata, if I say something I learned in a Mexican prison, I would just say Mexican prison. Or Mexican jail. I picked the town, which lets you know, like, I'm burning calories. You know what I mean? I'd go, a little something I learned in a Mexican prison. And then I would say the thing. But I did the outside of Cottonelle Dos Playas. So good on you. Who was that? Who was that on Twitter? And look, if I can bring happiness or a smile to the face of just one person watching that, I have failed miserably.
Yes, hello. My name is Graham Wellington.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Who Max Beta? Is it a white man?
Yeah, Jeremy it Nelson is his name. There you go. At Stickman 13.
Oh, sorry, my screen is now down.
It's Jeremy Wilson.
Yeah.
Oh no, I took it off the.
Good on you. Okay. Good on you, Jeremy.
All right. Let's see. Sonny Carolla is here today. I think we're gonna put him on the mic.
So we're on gloves on his gloves.
Oh man, he is. Shaking in his
rolling in his gerbil
his boots. Yeah. I don't want to play the outtakes, Max Beta. Sorry. But we had some other time. There's some extra material we can get into if we want.
Did you pick the final product or did you shoot fat and they edited what they wanted?
we shot pretty fat, which is always going to happen. And then you edit it, because if they edit it, it's going to be problems. And then you sort of argue over like one you need to lose or one you don't need to lose. It's always a little insulting because they want to trim 9 seconds out of it. And it's like, I don't know. Do we have to trim 9 seconds out of it? Like, why is that so? There's an element
of... Am I not worth 9 seconds?
Is that going to make or break the special? Yeah.
I've run into this a lot. Like, it's like when I would do bits with Dancing with the Stars. Really what it is, this is going to sound like a pejorative, but it's not. They want to put their stink on it. Like, they want to put their hands on it. They want to give their input. If you just hand them something, they'll go, oh, okay, here's a couple things we'd like to, whatever. And it takes out 9 seconds. It adds 2 seconds. Like, it's nobody knows, nobody cares, but they still,
look, they were involved.
They're compelled to go, here's what I would do. Yeah. And here's what we want. It's just so you can have that stupid back and forth. You know what I mean? Right. Like, there's always like, oh, okay, they got an email. Here's what they want. Here's what we want. And we want to do this. And it's just, that's the nature of the beast. And for me, I'm a little more like when I get my hair cut and the chick goes, you want it round or square in the back? I go, whatever you want. I'm not interested. And when she hands me the mirror to look at the back of my head, I go, no, take the mirror. I'm fine. I don't want to give input on stuff that really doesn't make a difference. If the bit is 2 minutes and 9 seconds or 2 minutes and 2 seconds, it's just, who cares? They shot it for free. They sent it in. It's funny. The first joke, well, Max Zapata can find it. They wanted to cut this baseball season joke, which it's like it's an okay joke. It's just it's a little more. Certain jokes are for certain functions. This isn't just like a laugh out loud joke. It's a kind of to get you into the bit joke. I don't know if Dawson has it.
Well, I'm glad you understand that certain jokes are for certain functions. When you said they wanted to cut something, I thought it was going to be Sean Hayes' comeback joke again.
No, I left the show.
Sometimes jokes don't work.
I'll play it.
Maybe not for the Feeding America.
We're queuing it up.
We'll figure it out. All right, if it takes a minute, then we'll just drag Sonny in here. So Sonny and I were driving along today, went out to Malibu, got up early, went out to take a drive in Malibu. And we're going over what the experts were saying. We just got the news that LA was going to be shut down for another 3 months, although it'll be opening in different forms.
Right.
But the shutdown, see, here's the problem. For Sonny, who doesn't have a job and doesn't have much, his friends are affected by the shutdown. So they can't hang out. I don't know what the rules are. So the governor says you can go to the beach as long as you're running and wearing a mask. No stopping and laying down on a towel, and you can walk on a horse trail as long as you keep safe distance. And we'll have businesses open, but they're going to have to bring you your stuff curbside, because I know ladies like to bra shop curbside. I'll be at that curb, Ginny. Tell me which corner.
Yeah, I'll let you know.
But just a bunch of stupid like. Some stuff is, see, some of this stuff makes sense. And then other stuff is me saying to my son, hey, when you walk home, if you walk around every telephone pole twice, you won't be abducted. And then he feels good about himself. Like, okay, I can walk home and I'll feel safe about myself. So some of this is just that. It's always just that. We're going to do something. We're going to engage in something. And we're going to pretend like we're doing something. So I was explaining to Sonny, who's locked down. Yeah. What's the deal with your friends? You can't see them?
No. They.
It's like it's cruel. It's like they're a bunch of kids. Yeah. The kids don't get sick, number one. Number two, everyone's healthy and 13, and they could be shooting a basketball around in my backyard right now, but it's not allowed. So, and I don't care, Sonny, you can go hang out with your friends, but obviously all the other families care. And I had this theory as I was explaining to Sonny about experts. I was explaining to him Barbara Ferrer, who's the LA County Health Director, PhD in social welfare, by the way. So I this notion of, hey, there's this one person who has a PhD in social welfare and will set all policy based on this one person or whatever she's gleaned? Like, what about some other voices in this mix? But anyway, she has now recommended another 3 months, which means Sonny's going to, like, just pass at least through half the summer with not hanging out, not shooting the ball, not wrestling, not playing Marco Polo.
That's all of summer. Like,
that's all
three,
of summer.
3 months from now is when school starts back up.
All right. So
how convenient.
I told him, Sonny, here's...
Yeah, they want school back in mid-August.
Here's Daddy's relationship with experts. And it was funny because I told Sonny, take a picture of yourself and send it to Chris Maxipata. I remember a long time ago when an expert told me if you didn't wear a corrective helmet, your sunglasses weren't going to sit right on your head. Mm-hmm. And it was ironic that Sonny was wearing his sunglasses and driving next to me, and the sunglasses were sitting just right. So here's the thing about the experts. If you're going to go in and you're looking at some getting a joint replaced, by all means, talk to an orthopedic surgeon and listen to that person's expertise. But it's not all experts all the time. And I also got to think about an agenda. This person was an expert who wanted to sell me a $4,000 hockey helmet. Mm-hmm. So they're vested
in their expertise.
Yes. Well, and in the macro sense of that, one way of thinking is if we declare this crisis over, then where does that emergency funding go?
We don't
get it anymore.
No, but it's interesting, and there's some powers at play here.
What's interesting, Adam, is that like the woman you mentioned, I forget her name, but like
Barbara Ferrer.
It would be nice if there. I haven't done a deep dive into this, but it'd be nice if there was some more transparency. Like you mentioned, she's the one person making. I don't know. Maybe there's a whole panel. Maybe there's a whole panel of doctors and experts. It'd be nice to know. It'd be nice to hear from them. It'd be nice to know the reasoning behind. Don't stop at the beach, which seems kind of crazy. But if there's a reason, it'd be sure nice to know that. Otherwise, we're just kind of hiding behind this cloak of expertise, I guess, and just saying, listen to what we say, and not here's the reason behind it.
Well, I was thinking about it when I was thinking about Sonny and his poor friends who he can't see all summer because of, and I'm not sure. I know there's this thing where we go, hey, here's what's going to happen. But we also have to think about the likelihood of that happening, which is I'll give you a right-leaning version of that. I remember years ago when there were some, they wanted to put some initiative on the ballot that said, we want to add 25 cents onto a pack of every cigarette. And we'll add 25 cents and that money will go to the Lung Association or something. And obviously, Big Tobacco started coming out with commercials. And the commercials were not wanting against that. But there was the scare commercials. There were the scare commercials. So what kind of commercials did you get? Gangbangers will go to Nevada. They'll fill their vans with cartons of cigarettes. Then they'll come back here and sell them in front of the liquor stores at a discount. And guess where that money's going? And the guy's like, you know what that money? You know I can buy a whole lot of? You know, like lift his T-shirt and he had a gun stuffed into his trousers. And I was like,
ooh, that's a lot of cigarettes.
Is this really going to happen?
Right.
Like, I don't think it's going to happen. And so the same thing works this way. It's like, what's wrong with Sonny? He's 13. His friends are 13. They're not infected. It'll pass right through them. If they get it, they don't even know they're going to get it. Yeah, okay, all right. But then what if they're playing together and then one of them goes to a nursing home and vomits all over the patients? Then what? It's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, well, that'd be a worst-case scenario.
Yeah, what if he hotwires a fucking Jeep and drives it through the nursing home? I guess that would be bad, too. Like, okay, you're going to come home and what? You're going to infect the elderly. Well, here's the deal. You don't live with elderly people.
Yeah, so I'm fine. I don't know
I'm fine, too. You live with me. I don't give two shits. So go out and play and then come home. And if for folks who are living with their grandparents, well, then that's another consideration they should have. That's the way life should work.
The other thing that I don't and if they're saying that sunlight and UV rays and that sort of thing at least hampers the virus, if not kills it directly, then wouldn't a proper protocol be go to the beach, let kids play with their friends. It's summertime. Get out there, soak up as much sun and vitamin D as possible. And then if there's a second wave in the fall, then we'll see about locking down again. But now's the time where we really encourage you to be outside and yes. be in the sun.
I concur. So anyway, Sonny is game. I don't know if his friends, parents are, but also there's this thing, like I was thinking about, you hear about those 48-hour stories or 2020 stories. I don't even know if those shows are on anymore, but they used to have those stories about the wife was poisoning the husband, slowly poisoning the husband to collect on the insurance. I realize the news is slowly poisoning the wives.
Oh.
The wives are poisoned with fear. They watch the news all day. They're all agitated and whipped up. Lynette and Natalia come in every day like, I don't know if we should go on this trip. I don't know if we should allow it. It's like they ingest all of this news. They're poisoned by fear. And the guys, what are you going to do? Be the boogeyman? You can't live with a person mm-hmm. who's poisoned by fear and go against them. So what happens is I think the dads are a little more pro go out and play with your friends. The wives are more against it. Don't get me wrong. The men are poisoned as well, but the women are really, they have a lethal dose of this fear poison. And thus the answer is lock it down.
I mean, mom wouldn't, she made me go inside from swimming because it was too cold yesterday. I don't know.
No.
Too cold. Well, you're going to catch a cold. It's got the word cold in it, right?
Yeah.
It's just good gypsy science. All right, Sonny, don't turn out like anybody but me.
Okay.
All right. See ya, champ. You got anything right. you want to say?
That was just a waste of my time.
All right. All right. Do it with a little more.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? Gusto.
Just give us that lock out.
Come on.
That was just a waste of my time.
All right. Give us three. Give us
three clean.
Give us angry. That was just a waste of my time.
That was just a waste of my time.
I went angry. Angry.
Go up. Sonny, go up on time. That was a waste of my time. You know what I mean? Finish on it up now.
That was just a waste of my time.
All right, that's good. Ooh, okay. That's good. Give us
and give us like two cool cavalier. Like that's a waste of my time.
Oh, that was just a waste of my time. Oh, that was stupid. That was bad.
Cool guy.
You're better. And I know your friends are constantly telling you to emote, but I really want you to do it this time. Go ahead, emote.
That was just a waste of my time.
Okay.
All right.
And one more. You've gotten Corona 19. Your feet are purple and you're dying in a hospital bed on a respirator.
You're feeble.
And I say to Sonny, I say one last time, say your line.
That was just a waste of my time.
Good cough. Well-placed cough. All right. Nice, Sonny.
That was really good.
Hit the bricks.
Yeah.
Have fun.
Any last words?
All right. Thanks, Sonny. We got some phone calls up here. I want to just... someone has got thoughts about San Francisco line 3. Hey, Erica, 56, San Francisco.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. How you doing?
I'm doing pretty well.
Good. Comment?
Yeah, what's going on here in San Francisco? We are giving free alcohol, cannabis products, and cigarettes to people who are in the hotels that we are handing over to the homeless people.
Are they allowed to smoke in the room? Because if I smoked in a hotel room, I'd be arrested. Are they?
Yes, they are. They are. It's allowed. It's sort of this new form of faux tenancy.
They're allowed to smoke in the room. Now, look to be genuine here, obviously it's insane. San Francisco's jumped the shark and so on and so forth. But I get it. If you go, these guys are going out every night and they're looking for pot or they're looking for booze or whatever. And if we give it to them, they can stay in. There's some version of that that makes sense. Here's the issue with California, as I sort of realized. And I think it's what will kind of undo a society, which is we have rules. but we only really enforce those rules if you pay taxes and are a good citizen. If you're sort of rogue, if you don't pay taxes, you want to live outdoors, or you want to shit on the sidewalk, or you want to live for free in a hotel room, then we don't really have those rules. I mean, look no further than smoking. I would pay for my room, but I couldn't smoke in my room. He who doesn't pay for his room may smoke free cigarettes in the room. That's California in a nutshell. You want to smoke in the city of Burbank, where we're at. If you want to smoke, it's illegal. If you choose to smoke walking down the sidewalk, then you'll get a $200 ticket, or in a park, or anywhere in Burbank. That shall be vigorously enforced. There's also an ordinance that says you can't use leaf blowers, which causes much more harm to your lungs than secondhand smoke. Anyone knows if you're walking down the sidewalk and someone else is walking past you by the sidewalk, if they're smoking a cigarette, you can smell it, but you don't have to cross the street. If a guy has a leaf blower out in the sidewalk, you have to cross the street or turn and pick an alternate route. And I guarantee whatever's in the air because of the leaf blower is worse for your lungs than the secondhand smoke of the person on the beach, in the park, or on the sidewalk. That's clear. That's a scientific fact. Yet, we will charge the person smoking the cigarette $200. That will be vigorously enforced. We will never enforce the leaf blower. Well, then where are we living? What's going on? Why bother anymore? If your rules in California is if you play by the rules, you'll get more rules. If you don't play by the rules, you can do whatever you want. We're like in and out of prison. If you steal something, we're not going to arrest you unless it's over $995 or whatever. We just don't have rules for people who don't want to play by the rules. Now, as I've said, either don't enforce any of the rules, like let people smoke on the beach, or enforce all the rules equally. That's a fine society. The chasm between what they enforce and whom they enforce them with and those where they look the other way is growing bigger every month. And that's the undoing. That's the undoing of a society. A society that works just has rules. No sleeping on the sidewalk. Well, that's for you, and you, and it shall be vigorously enforced, or leaf blowers, or cigarettes, or whatever that is. You can't have two sets. You know what wouldn't work? You know what wouldn't work? If I parented and I had a set of rules that I were very disciplined about with Sonny and not with Natalia. If I just went, hey, here are the rules. You have to be in by 10 o'clock at night. You have to make your bed, and you have to do your chores on Saturdays. And Natalia did none of them, and I never enforced that. And then Sonny was getting grounded constantly because he came home too late or he didn't do his chores. How long would that last? How long before Sonny just said, fuck this, I'm leaving?
Rules like do your homework or don't, or we'll burn him in the pool.
Mm-hmm. Burn him in the pool. Yes. All right. Any opinions, or are we just going to make jokes?
I was looking at the I was looking at, because it sounded crazy, but in fact yes, they are providing weed and yeah, a certain alcohol and such. I'm reading a USA Today article from today, ironically. Conservative nonprofit Turning Point USA posted a meme to Facebook alleging the policy misused tax revenue, when in fact the San Francisco is providing them with private donations. So still crazy, but not taxpayer paid.
Right.
Well, yes. To jump in, it is taxpayer, because the Department of Public Health is the administrator. So they're the ones who are doing the heavy lifting here. So yes, they did receive private donations, who chose to be anonymous, but the city is doing the actual work in order to make it happen. So they tried to back away from that fact. I'm a reporter and I did a story on it, and it got pretty convoluted.
Well, either way, whoever's paying for it, it seems like...
Well, we are.
Well, okay. Well, we're going to pay for it one way or the other. I mean, here's the deal with the homeless. The homeless criminals, homeless people legally selling food on the street, leaf blowers or whatever. If you keep looking the other way, if you keep accommodating, they will grow. The numbers shall grow. That's just the way it is.
This doesn't feel like the most effective way to treat or care for, quote unquote, the people who are addicted.
Well, it's also... You also have to realize as well, that when you have a large group of vulnerable people sleeping on the street every night, that's bad. But when a pandemic blows through town, then it turns into DEFCON 5, right? So it's like you're constantly, it's like you, your city, if you're going to have 60,000 homeless people or whatever we have in Los Angeles or what do we have in California, you know, tens of thousands of homeless people. This is essentially like saying, I'm going to drive my car with no seatbelt and the door open on the driver's side the whole time. It's like, okay, that may work, but if you hit a speed bump or there's an issue or you get sideswiped, you die. So this is like, we have this huge vulnerable population, over 150,000 in California. We don't do anything about it. Fine. They on any given Tuesday night, 150,000 people just be asleep on the sidewalks and shitting on the street. Fine. We'll step over it. But if there's a pandemic or I don't know, what if there's a weather front, you know, I don't know, what if there's some crazy ice storm or cold snap or heat wave or something, you know, some shit, the rats get bubonic plague. Like if some shit happens, those people are fucked. And now we have to deal with those people. Now we have to give them hotel rooms. And once you give them hotel rooms, like we're way down the road now. We're way past the point where we can go give them a shelter and give them some rehab. No, we have to give them drugs in their hotel rooms and cigarettes because we're in DEFCON 5. We're past the point. Yeah.
And
yeah.
When this all sort of, when we get on the other side of that and things get back to usual, as it were, how do these hotels rebrand themselves? When you housed, you know, a drug addicted homeless people with a fatal disease in your hotel, how do they get that business back on track? Seriously.
Well, I got to tell you, I mean, I'm so curious, Erica, about people just sitting and smoking in that room because, like, James Baby Doll Dixon literally like fought a guy in the hall who was trying to get in his room. It was like James smokes in his room and then sprays cologne all over the place, you know, and he got like a. Sir, we have a report that somebody, you can't come in. I have the key. Don't come in. He's like fighting with the guy in the door and he's trying to push his way in. But James is a taxpayer. Yeah.
Feels like a real missed opportunity too, because like Dr. Drew said, you'd want to get all of, you know, people on the street treatment who need treatment or treatment who want treatment. You've got a very rare opportunity to have them all in a hotel that you control. You know what I mean? Like this would be a great opportunity to get them some treatment, but instead you're just, you know, kind of in, you're putting a Band-Aid on the situation. I'm sure they feel better for that night or that afternoon or whatever, but this is not solving anything.
Well, I can tell.
That is exactly what it is. Exactly. And, you know, we're so devastated here because we did have this opportunity and the city blew it.
I will guarantee you that if somebody made the decree, you may stay in these hotel rooms and you may get your cigarettes and tobacco, but you're going to have to enter at a certain point a counseling situation or center, like we're going to provide rehab. Or those are the terms of staying in this hotel. I guarantee the ACLU would step up and fight for the rights of the homeless people. They're not fighting for the rights of the chick in Dallas who wanted to open her hair salon or get arrested. But they would definitely protect the homeless people, sadly. But the name, the rebranding, there used to be a place when I was a kid called the Vagabond Inn.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's Vagabond
right.
Inn.
Still there.
USC.
It's time for them to rise like a phoenix from the ashes and come back.
It's like Fatburger in the age of keto. It's like, we're back, baby.
That's
the
right.
Bindlestick Sweets.
What was the, do you guys remember the Vagabond Inn? Do you remember
there were two within a quarter mile of USC.
There's still one in Ventura.
Really? Yeah. Still one in Ventura. It's a weird name for weird, it's an interesting name to pick for your motel.
Yes.
The Ramblin' Ne'er-Do-Well Inn.
Erica.
Telling your luck in.
Erica, do you say you write articles?
Yes.
You're a reporter?
Yeah, I'm a reporter. Yeah, for City Journal. And the story just came out and it's really causing quite a kerfuffle. So, and by the way, they are also getting free leaf blower.
Free leaf blowers. Yeah, we're going to have to make a move here. It's just there's going to have to be some parenting is going to need to be done. And at some point, you know, the city officials are the parents, essentially.
Can I ask Erica a question?
Yes.
Sure.
Erica, my wife, Christy, had heard, I think today or last night or whatever it was, that a lot of tech companies, Facebook, Twitter, and I believe Google and probably a lot of others are there's some version of their either not demanding employees come back or letting them stay at home the rest of the year or
they never have to go back.
Yeah. You're up there, Erica. Have you heard about this?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, they're fleeing, the buildings are going to be abandoned. Who's going to be the next leaseholder? Everyone's just kind of throwing their hands up in the air going, well, we have no idea. So there are going to be a lot of open spaces, open buildings, complete change of pace for what the city is going to look like. And I'm sure every city in the U.S., but certainly, yeah, the tech companies are gone. An interesting point, Mark Benioff of Salesforce, his whole building is empty. He could have put on, he was so eager to make sure that our homeless population does have services. He could have brought them into the building. Perfect.
Well, not his building. I gotta say, I was just doing a CarCast a half hour ago, and World of Speed outside of Portland, right? That's about 20 minutes. Wilsonville. State of the art, 53,000 square feet, state of the art automotive museum. They're under. They're done. They're pulling the plug.
That's crazy.
This is a beautiful, high tech museum. It's a beautiful, I was there a few months ago. It's a beautiful facility. 53,000 square feet. I mean, it's a big place, and it's like, we're no more. We're done.
I mentioned it on the podcast a few weeks ago, but Google is building a new LA headquarters at the old West Side Pavilion Mall just down the street from my house. There's construction going on as I speak. I give it a 50-50 chance of being done. Like, it's like gutted right now, and they're supposed to be making this. Like, in what world does that make sense in like 2020, 2021? You know, that's not a good, it's not a good use of foresight, unfortunately.
I don't know. And again, I'm picturing owning a 50,000 square foot museum, and they're under. They're done. They can't maintain it. I mean, obviously, they're shut down. They can only be shut down for so long before they have to just sort of declare bankruptcy and sell the place off, loan all the cars out to other museums, and that's what they're doing. Now, in my world, maybe we could let people visit the museum who weren't elderly or some version of this other than shut it all down in perpetuity, and now people are going under. They're selling their businesses. And here's the part they never tell you about. I toured that museum. I'll tell you what they're proudest of. It wasn't the exhibits and the cars and the lounge and stuff like that. They spoke with the most pride when they spoke about the back area. There's a whole back area where they were restoring cars. And guess who was restoring them? High school students. And they're telling me, these young guys, they didn't have a place to go. And now we're teaching them a trade. And they're learning on the job. And some of these guys are like at risk. But now they have a new lease on life. And it's like all gone. It's all gone. It's all done with. Because you wouldn't let 17-year-olds go back into a building with other healthy people and turn a wrench. Okay. So, I don't know. Everyone's plan is we're not moving anywhere until it's 1,000% safe. Well, what about the at-risk youth who had a job at the museum, an apprenticeship at a museum working on cars, having a trade, something they could feed themselves and their families with at some point? That's all out the window. So, I don't know. I count that. That's my thing. I factor that in. Yeah. It's a factor. Nana dying at a nursing home at 86 years old is a factor. And a 17-year-old being put out on the street because they don't have a place to go after school, although there is no school, that's another factor.
There were to be a school.
Factor it in. All right. Thanks. Who were we just talking to?
That was Erica.
Erica.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I was going to ask if it was Erica Sandberg, the reporter. Is that Erica?
Yeah.
That's very nice. Oh, very good.
Keep up the reporting over there, Erica.
Hey, thanks so much. You too. Bye.
All right, thanks for listening. All right, we'll bring on Theo Rossi in a second. First, I'll tell you about Liquid IV. Easy, healthy solution for dehydration. One stick of Liquid IV in 16 ounces provides as much hydration as 2 to 3 bottles of water. Proper hydration. It is critical. Good for your immune system. Also, it has as much C as an orange, as much potassium as a banana. I always remember that when I'd say to Drew 20 years ago, well, if I'm hungover, what should I do? He'd go, eat a banana. Well, that's why.
Of course, don't drink so much.
Yeah. Well, that
helpful.
That was off the table. Plus, vitamin B3, B5, B6, B12. Liquid IV's donating 2.3 million servings in response to COVID-19 situation out there. And they're donating the servings to hospitals and first responders and food banks and veterans and active military. This stuff's good. Throw some in your car, shake it up in the water bottle. Again, if you've been out celebrating alone these days, but celebrating a little too much the night before. And when we get back to normal, we do a little travel. Take them with you. No artificial flavors or preservatives. Right, Dawson?
Liquid IV is available nationwide at Target, Whole Foods, and Costco. Or you can get 25% off when you go to liquidiv.com and use code Adam at checkout. That's 25% off anything you order when you use promo code Adam at liquidiv.com. Get better hydration today at liquidiv.com. Promo code Adam.
Actor, you know him probably best as Juice from Sons of Anarchy.
Yeah.
He'll also regular on Luke Cage from Marvel's Luke Cage Netflix show. We'll talk to Theo Rossi right after this.
Even people who disagree on everything agree on Adam Carolla's I'm Your Emotional Support Animal. Bryan Cranston says, Adam has done it again. In this book, he's managed to make me laugh at one moment, then cry out, what an idiot, in the next. His own blue-collar mastery of the language invites the reader into the conversation, just like the podcast. So much so that I breezed through the book in only one sitting on the toilet. Pre-order I'm Your Emotional Support Animal now at adamcarolla.com.
Nice. Theo Rossi is with us. He's in Austin, Texas right now.
That's right.
Theory, yeah. With Theo Rossi is the name of the podcast. New episodes every week on Apple Podcasts, Podcast One, and Spotify as well. Good to meet you, Theo.
It's great to meet you, brother. How are you?
I'm doing How's well. Life? It's interesting, but as a person that likes to study people like Jane Goodall studies chimps, it's pretty rich for me. Although the chimps are all fighting now and flinging feces at each other, but I'm learning a lot.
Yes, I am with you. And I enjoy that study myself. And in the context of using the word interesting, usually when I say someone is interesting, it's not a good thing. I say they're
You cannot imagine how wrong you are.
That's Jane Goodall telling me I'm 1,000,000% wrong. Well, yes, but, you know, you really learn something during the interesting times. The good times, you don't really learn that much. You know, it's that when the team loses that you really learn something. Like when you watch the Last Dance with Michael Jordan, it's the three times that guy's lost in his entire career, those are the times where he really learned something, you know. What is Austin like? Because Austin is not really Texas per se, right? Like it's its own vibe over there, right?
Little vibrant oasis.
Yeah. I mean, I would never have thought in my life that I would be here. You know, we got here about 2 years ago after we had my second son. I got two little boys that are 2 and 4. You know, I was in LA 15 years. I grew up in New York City. I went back to New York for 4 years. My wife's from Houston. And she was like, what the fuck are we doing here in New York? It was freezing. It was freezing. And I said, well, I can't go back to LA. I was finished. I had run my course there. And I didn't know where else I was going to live. And I never in my life thought I'd be here. But I came here. I was here 24 hours. And I said, I want to live here. And I want to raise my kids here. And it's an incredible place.
Well, speaking of Houston, I'm going to Houston to do benefit shows for the food bank and folks. Anyway, I'm doing it at the Houston Improv. I think that was, what, the 21st or the 24th, 23rd? And all I can think of is where can I go to eat after I do one of those shows? Because I'm in L.A. and I haven't been out to dinner in 3 months. And the greatest joy in my life is going out and having a steak and a martini. And it's driving me insane that I can't do that. And when I go to Houston, that's what I'm doing. But I need
some
suggestions.
You have the you have the I mean, that is the ultimate spot for exactly what you're talking, steak and martinis. I will have to ask my wife, as that's her dojo. I'm still getting used to it. I also kind of hide out no matter where I live. So I could be anywhere. That's amazing. So you're going there to do shows, right? Because we're kind of open here. Like, that's the difference here. My family in New York, they're doing what they're doing. And it's been, you know, a bit of a decimation over there, but we don't really feel it here. It was like, it's a little different here is what I would say. So I can imagine in Houston, it's going to be totally different. You're going to be going to restaurants and stuff.
God. I'm going to be running. If you guys ever saw that part of the movie Tommy, when he got his eyesight back and his hearing back, and he just got in his underpants and he was just running down the street screaming, "I'm free," and throwing his arms up in the air. That's what I'm going to do. You're going to hear that song, "I'm free," in your brain when I hit
in the
streets.
Underwear.
Yeah. I'll go with the midways. I probably won't go with the tidy whities. But so it's interesting. So in LA, obviously you can't do it. In Houston, you can. I think I heard that Texas has about 3/4 the population of California, but half the COVID-related deaths. And we're on the low side. So California is low anyway, and Texas is way low. So Texas is going, no reason for us to go full Bad Ronald and hide in a wall underneath a staircase. We've got half of what California has.
But again, do we know anything?
No.
Do we know anything that we write? You know, do we? When I hear something, I go, I don't know. I don't know anything. So it feels like, you know, every day it changes. All I know, the only thing I can relate to is New York, because my family, my brother-in-law is, you know, a firefighter. All my friends are cops and they're kind of in the mix. People work in the hospital. I know that because that's real. That's tangible. I can see that. But here and in LA, I know you guys just got till July. I don't know. I don't know anything. I'm hiding in the house.
I don't either. But I think Mike was telling me that you guys are about 3/4 our population with about half of what we have.
Yeah, so, definitely.
I'm definitely going to be enjoying myself
in the underwear.
In the underwear. I'm going to get a haircut. I'm going to get a steak. I'm going to get a martini. I'm going to be my underwear.
All the things.
It's going to be awesome.
He's doing a month's worth of time in like 2 days.
Yeah. I'm going to get off the plane and I'm going to scream, "I got a lot of living to do." And I'm going to kiss the first man I pass. And then I'm going to run down the street yelling, "I'm free."
That was a great double "Bye Bye Birdie" and the Who reference.
Yeah. Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, I got a lot of living.
Hey, we'll take a word for it, okay? Yeah.
That was a test. It's going to be like Supermarket Sweep, but it's going to be like Normal Life Sweep. And you're just going to be doing all the things you can in 48 hours.
And then it all gets foiled because he falls in the beginning and something breaks. And
he's in traction.
Max Zapata, can you find that scene from Tommy where Roger Daltrey gets his scene back? It's probably where they just play that song. That's a weird movie, by the way. Go ahead.
While he's looking for that, I have a culinary question for Theo. You're in Austin. I've had the pleasure of visiting. What do you, as a relative newcomer, what do you think is of a higher quality? The tacos or the barbecue? They're both excellent.
Tacos.
Really?
Not even a question. Yeah.
The tacos are pretty awesome there.
Pretty awesome. Yeah. And that's coming from living in LA for a long time, you know, and I lived predominantly in like East LA by Eagle Rock for a while. I mean, I was getting some really good food down there. This is a different level on the taco spectrum.
Really?
They're pretty great.
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Yeah. And listen, it's a pretty good foodie town, man. And I'm not a big foodie.
Better than the Jon Favreau taco truck movie taco?
If Leguizamo was making it, maybe. It depends if him or Cannavale. I don't know who's making it.
You got a little Leguizamo in you.
I got a little Leguizamo in me. I got a little of everything in me. You know, I don't really fit into anybody's box, apparently. But, you know, that's fine. I'm cool with that.
I would just, you know, I would do barbecue one night and tacos the next night, but
spread it around.
How did they get to that next level with tacos over there? What's going on?
You know what it is? This is a very, you remember LA in like, kind of like right before all the madness, like late 90s, you know, early 2000s, when it was still like it felt like it was super creative everywhere, right? It wasn't so manufactured. Mm-hmm. Austin kind of has that. It is turning into a bit of a techie town, but it's super creative. It's a lot of like young people doing all this crazy stuff that you would never think of with food. And down by 6th Street, they close off that street every weekend. Everybody's out there partying and drinking. And the food is just a big part of what goes down here because live music is a huge part of it. So it kind of all goes in the same when everybody's all, can you curse on the show?
Go ahead.
Please. Please.
Right. Just when everybody's like, I'll just say messed up. When everybody's all messed up, they go late night eating. They do what they do. And they get, you know,
are they still having music and gatherings and groups? And how's that working?
Again, I've been hiding out since probably the 14th of March. And the reason being is because of the two young kids. And then also, I think I'm kind of more scared straight from New York because I'm talking with my family all the time and all that. I don't know if anybody's really doing that because I'm out in hill country. So it's kind of like I don't venture anywhere. I ventured out today for a minute and I had on the bandit thing. You know, I got the bandit.
The train robber.
The train robber. Yeah.
It's funny because most people, when they take the bandana off, look less like a criminal. But with that mustache.
This mustache is it.
With that mustache, you actually up your criminal game. Oh, you got the fade?
No.
I did the lines.
You carved the lines in your head.
Yeah. I'm giving myself haircuts. This is happening.
We have Tommy's. I'm free. So picture me running through the terminal of the airport in Houston
Hobby Airport.
Yes, 75. Good year. The year I was born. Let's see. There's explosions too.
Everybody has the respirators on.
This is very timely.
This is art.
Burned a lot of ground.
He's at the beach, Ronnie.
He was just in the forest.
This movie probably doesn't hold up.
No.
This clip doesn't hold up.
It depends. Who's watching it? It could. It went from Big Bear to the beach.
If you get Tina Turner as the acid queen, it helps.
Yeah, exactly. And he's looking at the camera. What a steady camera.
That's going to be me.
There it is. Into the barbecue place.
Right into Franklin's.
All right. We get it. That's what I'm doing in Houston. I'm going full Roger Daltrey. Shirt off.
Yeah.
Running. I'm growing my hair out. Remind me to
The white pants.
Remind me to grow my hair out. Put on my white.
Between now and then.
Put on my white flares and run through that airport.
Put on your white flares. That means that you have white flares. Oh, you didn't say go buy white flares.
But it also means I'm not wearing them now.
Yeah.
In my defense.
<That's true. laughs>
So it's interesting. You're talking about Austin and that's, you know, you're talking about L.A., you know, circa 1997, 98. And you coming from Eagle Rock, familiar with that area and Boyle Heights, Eagle Rock. And we all saw what kind of happened on Melrose and a lot of these places. And what Theo was kind of alluding to, which we should all sort of now get our best guesses in for Austin, which is at the beginning, it's all crunchy and cool and indie and everyone's doing their own thing. But I have this saying, which I think about often, which is what happens when you become the man? You know what I mean? Like what happens when Austin becomes all the things Austin was pushing against, you know, and then some other place will crop up somewhere. But it happens time and time again. You know, San Francisco, even like Melrose, Los Angeles, they're now the man now.
Ben and Jerry's at Haight Ashbury, you know, famous.
Right. And the best example is you can only get Burning Man tickets through Ticketmaster.
Right.
So it eventually goes that way.
And I don't think there's any clawing of it back. You just go to a new space and a new place, right, and then you have about a 12-year run where it from zero to the man, and then you have to go somewhere else. I don't know. Theo, You live there.
Yeah, no, I think, I mean, New York City is the best example ever. I mean, growing up, there were parts you wouldn't go near. There were parts that were super cool. Times Square was super dangerous. It doesn't make it better. It just means that it was more dangerous, which you felt more alive. And then it becomes what it becomes, right? And it becomes this different thing. And it, for some people, that Disney World feel of Times Square is amazing. You know, how safe the city has become and all that. And some people miss the grittiness and the unknowing of it. I think that, and what you said, I think it opens up another place. Like people are like, oh, Nashville and Austin, and then this will go and it'll be Portland and Anchorage. You know, who knows what it'll be? It'll be someplace and people will go.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I have a question. I was there like 5 years ago. I spent a weekend there and I remember the impression that the town of Austin had an aggressive attitude towards like corporations. Like, for example, there was no Uber and no Lyft. They had their private like Austin ride or whatever. Yeah. There was like, it was only one that existed within the city limits of Austin. And like, I was marveling at the lack of, I felt like it was McDonald's or fast food or whatever. Like, is it still that way? Is it still
No, because it's become a tech town now. So everybody from the Bay Area, everybody from Chicago's out here, everybody from the Bay, everybody from LA. I just got a call during this whole thing. I got a bunch of calls from people in LA who are like, hey, talk to me about it. I need more space for less money and no state tax. And, you know, people who just, especially in New York City, people just want to leave. No, it's not like that at all. Because Google's out here. Apple's out here now. Right. It's different. Different.
Hey.
And that happens with even people's careers and stuff. You become cool and edgy in the beginning. And then, you know, next thing you know, you're on CSI New Jersey. And it's like, that's kind of where it goes.
Yeah, it's a very astute point. Like, you know, Ray Liotta is doing Chantix commercials or whatever. And it's like that is Ray Liotta was edgy and cool and all these great parts and everything. And I was just like the Chantix guy, you know, and which I don't begrudge it. It's fine. He's getting paid. Who cares? But that is the course of life. Like that is how life sort of goes. You sort of become, everyone becomes the man. God and money, I should say, money turns everyone into the man eventually. If the city gets enough money, they will just become the man. Now, some companies, I used to work for K-Rock and MTV. So you want to talk about two companies that were the man who fought feverishly to pretend like they weren't the man?
Right.
Like K-Rock's the biggest radio station in LA in the world, maybe the second biggest market in the world, MTV. And you never saw more 45-year-old rich guys wearing flip-flops and board shorts. But they're driving a BMW 7 Series in where they're probably getting out of their wingtips and putting on their flip-flops to go into the building. Like literally. It's an interesting phenomenon. And then we all remember, it's like you take bands like Green Day. Oh, they used to play those little clubs in the Bay Area and they were so punk and they're so indie and they're so against everything. And then they sell 2 billion records and now somehow they become the man.
And they have a Broadway show.
Right.
Yeah. And I think that it's the ones who either die early or they just kind of disappear that keep that kind of legendary, you know, status of what it is.
Right.
But usually it becomes something else, right? You know, I guess the only one I would maybe think of is, but I think he even did like a Gap commercial, was Bob Dylan. Didn't he do some kind of thing years later?
Oh, well,
something?
We can look for that. Yeah, there's no doubt that if Lenny Bruce was still alive and you guys turned on Fox News tonight, he'd be hawking a CPAP cleaning device.
Well, speaking of Texas, the one man that I could guarantee would still be close, actually not close at all, but somebody I like just as much, Bill Hicks, would have never turned into the man.
Yeah, I don't know.
Again, I think that when you look at the money aspect of it, is a lot of people sit back and go, I can do this, but fuck, even though they're better, like comedian-wise, acting-wise, or whatever, but then you have these other people that are half as talented, have no talent, they're making all their money, they're not worried about anything. And that's what money does to people. And I think now, honestly, with what's going down in the world right now, I think that's why we're kind of entering into this weird age of authenticity, that if you're not like the real deal, you're kind of starting to be found out because you look silly. if you're sitting there talking about your 27 cars or your
23, you but go ahead.
23. But no, that's, I wanted to get into that. Talk about when you were going to start giving two of them away at least. But no, it just looks a little silly. And again, it's, if you own it, that's cool. But if it's like a falsehood, which seems to be a lot of people, and we're seeing that with all the agencies and all this shit, people are like going under left and right.
I had something in my head when you're talking about what happened to Times Square. And there was that song. Who sung Hot, 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 Dawson?
Buster Poindexter?
Yeah, he has a real name.
He lived in Staten Island.
Buster Poindexter.
David Johansen?
Yeah, David Johansen. Buster Poindexter. Yeah. He had a song off an album from like 1997 that talked about what happened to Times Square. Like how it used to be fun with all the whores and all the gangsters and all the whatever, and basically Disney moved in. And it's a really funny, it's a upbeat, funny song that in the vein of his types, Hot, 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 or his types of songs. And it, I don't know, it just popped into my head when Theo was talking about what happened to Times Square. He kind of captures it. Yeah, Max Pratt,
I used to see him.
Go ahead.
I used to see him and I used to freak out when I saw him. I mean, he was... Back, what was that? When Hot, Hot, Hot was out, when is that? Because then he did a movie where he played a bad guy or something.
He was in Scrooge as the Ghost of Christmas Past.
Yeah.
Great scene, by the way.
Thank you. That's what I was thinking. He was the taxi driver.
Yeah, he was the Ghost of Christmas Past.
Yeah.
1987 was Hot, Hot, Hot. My album that I'm talking about was probably... 10 years later, probably 96, 97. I remember he came on Loveline and he gave me the album and I was listening to it. It made me laugh. Remember those days when someone would hand you a CD and you'd go, oh, thanks. And you'd pop it in your car on the way home and listen to it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's over with. I mean, now someone just said to me the other day, I'll send you a DVD. I said, I can't watch it anywhere. I don't know. I'd have to go watch it in my car. I don't know where to.
Is it to put my drink on or what?
What do I do with it?
Oh, it's 1997. It's called Buster's Spanish Rocket Ship. And you'll find the song about what they did to New York City, what they did to Times Square. I think we played it before, but it had to have been years. So anyway, Max Pat will look that up. You know, I had an idea, Theo, sort of based on what's behind you. I talk to smart people.
These are all fake.
Yeah, I was going to say, like,
they're all fake. It's wallpaper.
Everyone I see interviewed on TV has a wall of books behind them.
All false.
It's all false? Because if it doesn't exist, I want to make that scrim or that wallpaper because I got nothing behind me.
I can get this for you. I don't
You put that all up?
No.
Oh good.
I just had a couple of guys in here. We put the set together. How can I look the most intelligent? But if you look, there's actually none of them make sense. Nobody would.
None of the books. Oh, good. I don't feel better about myself.
Could the song you're looking for be called Nueva Broadway?
I don't think so. What are the songs on that album? Let's see.
Ondine or Ondine.
Yeah.
Nueva Broadway, Downtown Dream. Inez is just a big rage something. The Closer, My First Sin, Let's Take It Easy, Linda Lee. Iris Chacon, Skin and Bones, Mean Spirited Sal, Lay Down, and Rumba.
Oh, well, then play the Broadway one. Yeah, that must be the name of the song. That doesn't seem to be the refrain of it, but we'll see if this is that song. Oh, yeah, this is it. So if you listen to the words, they'll tell you what happened to Broadway. Or Times Square.
They start at minute 12.
I can't believe the things I see on Broadway today. The ladies of the evening are going away. Disney's built a fortress in the heart of Times Square. The most wholesome people will soon be there. They don't drink. They'll turn this town into a mall, and I don't know what to think. They don't smoke. They don't drink. They'll turn this town into a mall, and I don't know what to think.
like a visionary. I mean, he saw it happening. That was happening right there. Fabulous freaks you ever want to meet. To us, that emporium was built on hollow ground. But the city father shut it down.
They don't smoke. All right, you guys get it. But he's basically talking about Disney moving in and building them all.
Yeah.
Throwing all the weirdos out. All the lights of the night.
Dexter.
Yeah.
Dexter.
Well, he recorded that song in 96, maybe 97. I mean, it's been a while. But it's always...
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I left in 99. I got to L.A. in 99, October 31. So I was... I mean, he was... pretty, I didn't think it was still pretty gritty then, but he must have saw something that
here's an interesting idea. What town or city shapes their youth the most before they cast them free into society? So I'm from North Hollywood. I'm from the San Fernando Valley. There was no personality in the San Fernando Valley. There's no religion. There's no real team or anything. There's just kind of a bunch of people knocking around, playing sports, you know, looking for fun. But there's nothing to it. There's not even,
community.
There's not a twang that you get or a way of speaking or anything per se. It's just people living in crappy houses doing their own thing. Now, if you're from Boston, you get another thing. And if you're from Oklahoma, you get another thing. But, Philadelphia has its own thing. But, like, I don't know, what lays its stink on you more than New York or the New York of yore? Maybe today's New York doesn't have that effect. You know, Jenny from the Block and all that of the days of past. You know what I mean? But you take a look at Theo or many of these people you know, many of the personalities, you know, I don't know, Robert De Niro or whomever, but J-Lo or whatever. It's all been gentrified now, so maybe that part's gone. But what put more of its stink on you? Like, you could tell that guy's from New York. You know what I mean? Because you wouldn't say, you can tell that guy's from Valley Village or Encino or Sherman Oaks. Like, you wouldn't know.
He's definitely from Pasadena.
I was
know that
from
guy's
North
from
Hollywood. Same. People thought I was from New York. Like, that's how powerful New York is.
I would say New York has got to be number one. Texas can't be too far behind. And then, I mean, going back to the image of it all, that beach Cali, like the surfer Cali kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
That was pretty heavy.
Interesting. I think it's gone now with the tech boom and what's happened to the Bay Area. But there was a time when, like, you knew kids from Berkeley and, like, they were very liberal, very progressive. They rejected everything that was corporate and everything that was mainstream. Be like almost original hipsters in a way.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was a very specific time, but I think it's kind of gone now, is my guess, because it's very gentrified.
It's interesting that all that sort of New York, forget about it stuff that we kind of grew up with in movies and in real life, it was based on something. If you're 3 years old and living in New York now, you're just a rich kid, right? Like, I mean, you're not going to have all that edge and all that grit and all those calluses on you, right?
Only if you're in Staten Island or the Bronx or parts of, certain parts, again, certain pockets from experience. I think there's certain pockets, but definitely not Brooklyn, definitely not Manhattan. I mean, Manhattan's really always been where no one who lived there was from New York. It was always kind of the central meeting place, unless it was, someone who moved out there to work on Wall Street or whatever. But I think that the Bronx has still got some. Again, I don't know after this, I'm already seeing that a lot of people are like, I paid $5,000 for a one bedroom apartment and I'm working out of my house. Right. I got to get out of here. And I think that a lot of people are, I'm very curious of what New York looks like. There's your interesting Jane Goodall thing. What is it going to look like over there?
Well, maybe it'll be one of those weird apocalyptic things where all the rich people move out and the gangs start moving back in. We go full
Warriors.
New York. Yeah, Warriors.
Escape from New York.
So, what is...
Escape to New York.
Yeah,
Escape to New York. Warriors, one of the best movies ever.
I don't know much about Austin real estate. What are the price? All right, so I will say you lived in Eagle Rock area. Eagle mm-hmm. Rock area out in SoCal. Eagle Rock isn't Pasadena, but it's a little better than Glendale, a little hipper than Glendale. And mm-hmm. if you want to just see as the, if you're looking at it on a map, it'd sort of be between Pasadena and Glendale. It'd only be about 4 miles from Pasadena and 2 miles mm-hmm. from Glendale, right up on the border. So it's kind of like up and coming, kind of hip. It's like what happens is Silver Lake bled out. Silver Lake was a disaster, a lot of gangbangers and whatnot, and that got all gentrified, and then it sort of bled out into the surrounding areas. Eagle Rock would be one of them. But what would a home in Eagle Rock cost and a comparable home in the Austin area be?
Oh, I mean, I could tell you right now, right now what Eagle Rock costs, because I still got a lot of friends out there. I mean, I know it's jacked even in the years. I left probably 6 years ago total from L.A., and I think, you know, I could have probably bought, you know, something, not counting the house that I was in. Like, you could have got something for like $600-700, let's say $1,000 for like a nice, you know, good house. Those are probably like 1.1 now, 1.2. Again, pre all this, right?
Right.
But out here, just to give you an example, I was just at a friend's place. He has 75 acres. He bought it for $1.7 million.
Ooh.
75 acres. Wow.
It's awesome.
And so, and he's 23 minutes from the airport.
Wow.
You know, and I know he just bought it a couple of years ago. So again, it's different of what you're looking for, right? The downtown is a little more expensive. Again, after this, I don't know what that looks like living on top of each other. I think more people are going to start gunning for land.
Well, Chris is writing me a note here that talks about per square foot, which is, it's kind of how you do it. It's a little different because your friend has 75
different
acres.
Sorry,
but if you're just talking about square
regular
foot,
houses,
regular houses,
it depends on the area. Rich area out here.
According to Zillow, Eagle Rock has it at $550 a square foot, and Austin has it at $230. So less than,
depending on where you are.
When, of course, less than half. So I don't know. There you go, everybody.
And no state tax.
And no state tax.
Ooh. Average price of a home sold in Eagle Rock just over $1 million.
That's unbelievable. It's right. Unbelievable when you think about it, because it takes you 2.5 hours just to get to like the 101 if you hit it at the wrong time.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
But let's be fair. You get no land in a shitty school district. So, all right. Let me hit NetSuite by Oracle, and then we'll do some news. And Theo, you can hang out and do some news with us. NetSuite, Oracle, last few months taught us what's important in life and what we need to change. Same with business. What changes should you make? Do you have a hairball of multiple software systems? All you need is NetSuite by Oracle, the world's number one cloud business system. Finance, HR, inventory, e-commerce, everything you need in one place. Save time, save money, and headaches, whether you're doing a million or $100 million worth of sales. NetSuite gives you the visibility and control to manage every penny. Join the 20,000 plus companies who trust NetSuite, right, Dawson?
Receive your free guide, 7 actions businesses need to take now, and schedule your free product tour at netsuite.com/Adam. Get your free guide and schedule your free product tour right now at netsuite.com/Adam. netsuite.com/Adam.
All right, let's take a break. We'll come back with Theo and Bryan and Gina and do the news right after this. Well, Theo is going to hang in with us and crackwise and news, good sports as well. Lots of good stuff coming your way. First, Simply Safe. No one should feel unsafe at home, period. Fear has no place in your home, and that's why they're Simply Safe. They're on a mission from day one to make you safe. Protect your home today. Get free shipping. SimplySafe.com/Adam.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gina Grad. Breaking viral. All those crazy Trump tweets. Give me news with Gina Grad. Trouble in the Middle East. Celebrity drunk meltdowns. Need news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
I understand that this is a global podcast, but just coming over the wire right now, just because we were talking about it, LA County officials are now saying, you know, the safer at home order, which they're going to be less restrictive starting Friday. They're now saying all retailers can now open for curbside pickup, with the exception of anything in a shopping mall, essentially. Manufacturing and logistic businesses that supply those retailers can also open, and a variety of outdoor spaces, tennis courts, pickleball courts, shooting and archery, equestrian centers, bike parks, community gardens. Those will all be opening up in the next couple days, it looks like.
I literally drove past an empty tennis court today, and I thought, and the sun is shining and it's 75 degrees outside, like, why can't people play tennis? Yeah. You're so far apart. Nobody watches.
That's the game.
Like, it's such a weird... I also have been lamenting that every time I turn it on ESPN, they have the bunghole competition, the beanbag tossing, whatever.
Cornhole. Don't say bunghole.
It's not any better. Cornhole and bunghole.
Yeah, bunghole is something. There's a bung in a barrel.
It's a thing.
Yeah, the cornhole competition. I saw a guy. He was competing. He was, 40 pounds overweight, of course, as everyone is in those competitions. To be fair, the ladies are only 35 pounds overweight who participate. But the guy was competing in Crocs. And yeah. I thought, hey, buddy, we get it's not a real sport, but you don't have to advertise.
Literally, these are athletes.
You're wearing gardening clogs and participating in a sport. That's how little a sport it is. Have your own cornhole and shoes. I know it's been said many times, but I mean, volleyball has their own shoes. They play on a basketball court. Why can't you have your own shoes?
I could see a cleat working out with cornhole. You want to really
stability.
Stability. Stick that landing.
I smell a business.
Cornhole
business.
Cleats.
Or cornhole cleats.
Yeah, corn clogs, corn cleats.
I gotta shoot. The best part is when I shoot the commercial and they go, "How many times has this happened to you?" And we show an actor wearing regular sneakers and he's getting ready to throw the shot, but the bang goes over their head and it knocks a guy off a horse. A guy's just riding a horse, just boom, knocks him right off. And then we go, well, never again. And then we put the shoes on him, and it goes right. We cook it. It goes right through the hole.
Yeah,
right through the hole.
Then he gives you the over the shoulder Mentos.
That's right.
The guy on the horse nods approvingly.
Yeah,
that's right.
And then the corn cleats just come on the end. I mean, I think this is a no brainer right here.
I'm glad you brought this up, Adam.
He was wearing white Crocs. Once again, nothing says I'm not really competing in a sport like wearing white Crocs while you're competing in the sport.
The picture we're looking at, they're actually camouflage Crocs.
Oh, no. The guy I saw last night was wearing white Crocs. Evidently, it's
trying to hide them. Epidemic.
He doesn't want anyone knowing where those feet are.
I can't see them.
It must be funny. These guys, when they do their cornholing competition, there must be a point where someone is like setting up bleachers and chairs in the background and they're going, no one ever shows up. No, we're just doing it to pretend like the crowd couldn't get in. Because who the hell watches one of these things?
And by the way, put that picture back up for a second. Could it be sponsored by anybody else? Or does it have to
brats.
Be the Johnsonville Brat? That is perfect and beautiful and poetic, and I love it.
Yeah, not since the Oscar Mayer mobile rear-ended the Del Taco truck. Has there
That's
been
right.
something so, yeah.
Such a travesty.
Johnsonville brats. I know. It's perfect. It's phallic. It's fat guys. It's perfect.
It's delicious.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, moving on to something a little more national. President Trump has introduced a new term, Brian's favorite term, Obamagate.
Oh, thank God.
Nobody's quite sure what it means. President Trump might not be sure either. So here's the clip of him speaking about the term when a reporter from The Washington Post brought it up at a press conference.
What crime exactly are you accusing President Obama of committing? And do you believe the Justice Department should prosecute him?
Obamagate. It's been going on for a long time. It's been going on from before I even got elected. And it's a disgrace that it happened. And if you look at what's gone on, and if you look at now all of this information that's being released, and from what I understand, that's only the beginning. Some terrible things happened, and it should never be allowed to happen in our country again. And you'll be seeing what's going on over the coming weeks. But I wish you'd write honestly about it. But unfortunately, you choose not to do so. Yeah, John, please.
Crime. What is the crime exactly that you're accusing him of?
You know what the crime is. The crime is very obvious to everybody.
So nobody knows what the crime is. Now, this could be a sort of, this isn't what he's talking about, because he says this was something, you know, happening during his presidency, and it's been going on and on, you know, since time immemorial.
The crime is Flynn. The crime is Flynn. I don't know if it's to Obama, but it's Flynn is what he's talking about, or what they're talking about.
Right. So that's a big part of this phone call that somebody leaked when Obama was on some sort of teleconference with tons of staffers talking about what's going on with Flynn. And also, of course, and how that was handled. He was a House National Security Advisor, and how the coronavirus situation is being handled, which I'm guessing may have been a little more of a thumb to the nose to Trump more than possibly the Flynn, because it may have taken that a little more personally. Here's the part of the audio where he's talking about, where Obama's talking about the mishandling of this virus pandemic.
It's part of the reason why the response to this global crisis has been so anemic and spotty. And it would have been bad even with the best of governments. It has been an absolute chaotic disaster when that mindset of what's in it for me and to heck with everybody else, when that mindset is operationalized in our government.
I don't know who he's talking to. A lot of people, right?
Yeah, he was talking to a bunch of like Biden's base. So the next part of that is him saying, that's why we got to get out there and campaign hard for Biden.
Yeah, there's some meat on the Flynn bone. I don't know if it's getting all the way back to Obama, but there's going to.
Is it gate worthy?
Not Obamagate. It's more kind of FBI gate worthy, not necessarily Obamagate worthy, although we'll see how far back it goes. But there's going to be some stuff here, but again, I think it's a little more FBI gate and maybe even a little Jim Comey gate, but not Obama gate.
And I imagine the whole point of sort of holding on to it and then doing it now is, well, Obama, if you were involved, obviously that means Biden was involved. You know, he wants to tie that to Biden right now. I would imagine that would be important.
Well, some of it has been there's. So what happened was, is there was the whole Russian investigation.
Right.
And there was always talk that there was like a dossier and that it was not, it was, the dossier was paid for by the Hillary. Oh, by the way, when you hear about all this stuff, you just realize everyone's a fucking piece of shit. Everyone's up to something.
That's
everybody is up to something. That's what you learn. There was a Steele dossier. And the Steele dossier was originally kind of commissioned by the Hillary camp. And they found a bunch of stuff, but they found out that the dossier wasn't really provable. So, but what happened with the FBI is they just moved forward anyway. So they got Flynn. They wanted to talk to Flynn. It was kind of like a perjury trap. And they were looking to just sort of move forward. And so the whole time the left was moving forward with the Russian collusion and that whole world we lived in for the last 3 years, people on the right and some reporters on the right were moving ahead with the what happened with Flynn, what happened with the FBI, what happened with Comey and some of those other players. So they've been getting little bits and pieces of information that have been coming out slowly. Stuff has been classified. They've been having to lobby to release, you know, documents and stuff like that. And now they're starting to get these documents that suggest that some of the folks on the FBI side were not, sort of had their hands dirty too, were sort of not playing by the rules. The part that makes it Obamagate that they're talking about is someone is saying, well, how did Obama not know what the FBI was doing when he was in office? And then you make the argument, well, he didn't, or he did. But that's kind of the Obamagate. And then the Biden part is, well, you were there too. You know, that, right. That's what's going
and
on.
And it's not that the man is pristine and perfect. Let's not forget Fast and Furious, Operation Fast and Furious. I mean, that was some tough stuff, running all the guns to Mexico and tagging them and just seeing
there's
where they go.
There's been a few of those with Obama. It doesn't really get the media doesn't run with it because they didn't want to be called racist. Like you just it's look, pure and simple. It's like we had the first black president ever. This was historical. It was a big deal. And people were kind of like a little like, let's not pick on the guy. It's not a good look. It's like, he's our first, this is a historical event. And it was, and yep. I sort of get it. But what it means is everyone wasn't putting their jeweler's loop on and examining everything he did, which is just the same thing everyone else does. We just talk about it a little bit more or less than Trump, but yeah.
He also, like every other president before him, played ball. He wasn't just fast and furiously tweeting about, fuck this guy, fuck that guy.
No,
so it's a new world order.
I don't think there's going to be Obamagate per se, but there is little bits and pieces, and the stuff that's coming out is kind of going toward FBI and Comey and some of the other folks you heard from the FBI over the last few years. And there was an interesting thing. Stephanopoulos was interviewing Biden the other day, and he said, "Well, what do you know about this whole Flynn thing?" And Biden was like, "I wasn't there. I don't know about it." And then Stephanopoulos did his due diligence. He said, "No, you were present for when they were talking about Flynn and what they want to do with him." And he just kind of went, "Oh, I misheard you. Anyway, I don't know anything about it." But he had a reaction like, I'm getting away from this thing, which was interesting because it was sort of like, if it's a nothing burger, he spent a lot of energy getting away from it, from this, what we think's a nothing burger. It's an interesting, it was
an interesting approach. But that's not Biden's tell. Biden's tell, when he gets real mad and defensive, he'll call you Mac and he'll talk about corn pop.
No, what Biden...
He didn't do that.
Yeah, Biden will repeat himself like real sternly like three times in a row. It's an interesting thing. Max Pettit can look for it, but it was interesting. So I don't think it's going to get... I don't think it's going to be Obamagate. I don't really think it's going to be Bidengate, but it might be FBIgate.
Yeah. I'm grinding my teeth into a powder with every gate.
Sorry.
Yeah, he's not a fan. Right. Well, it is kind of a story on steroids, Brian. You are right.
Why would you do that to me?
So I know the enthusiasm is palpable for these cornhole tournaments, and yes. I'm going to give you a little bit more. I'm going to give you a little more raw meat. Good news. NASCAR returning Darlington Raceway on May 17th and getting right to it, according to Fox News. To reduce the amount of time teams have to spend at the track, the Cup Series is skipping practice and qualifying for the event. Here's how it's going to work. And Adam, you might be able to parse this out a little bit more. I'm going to read this right from Fox. So positions 1 through 12 will be determined by a random draw among charter teams in those positions based on team owner points earned through the first four races that were actually held before the season was suspended in March. The same process will be used for positions 13 through 24 and 25 through 36 separately, while the final four spots will be filled with non-chartered teams based on points with no draw. Does that make sense to you?
Well, the teams that were winning, so the reason they have qualifying is you want the fast guys up front, the slow guys behind them, and the slower guys behind them. Obviously, it's a shit show if you put the fast guys in the back and the slow guys in the front. There's going to be all knotted up in the first turn. So based on how many points you got in the first four races, if you have the most points, then theoretically you're one of the faster or the fastest person out there. So they'll put you on the pole.
Why is it a random draw among those teams?
Among how many teams?
12.
Oh, I don't know. It seems like they should just go points. Maybe because of the four races, the points are pretty knotted up. Like there's not
a big chasm
between the points.
Yeah.
And then you get like X amount of points for first, second, third, I don't know, through eighth place or something. And then they just cut the points off. But
that's happening.
People need to realize in racing, because I've lived it a few times, if you qualify seventh, it feels like you qualified low. But during the race, the number one car's on the left side of the straight. The number two car's right next to that car. It's just, they're right next to each other. It's just, if it's a left-hand turn, the pole guy gets to be on the inside left. And if it's a right-hand turn, the pole guy gets to be on the right-hand, kind of depending on the track. But the point is you think qualifying 7th or 11th puts you way back there. When you're in that race, you can see the guy who's on the pole, and it looks like he's three cars ahead of you, and you're driving down the freeway. Like, there's not a big separation. When you do 2-2 and 2, you're up further than you think. So,
yeah, anyway. It's not like you're lined butts to nuts, as they say in
That's
in
right. Hips or lips. That's what I say in NASCAR. Yeah, now who wants to go cornholing? Let me put my clogs on.
NASCAR is aiming to complete a full season, 36 race season, and the schedule for June and beyond is still developing. And while we talk about good old-fashioned summer fun, if you're missing the funnel cakes, the deep-fried Oreos, all the awesome stuff at the state fair, a Northern Ohio state fair is going to let you do the county fair in your car. Stark County, and by the way, I think there's, I heard rumblings of OC Fair thinking about doing this, but Stark County is opening its county fair this weekend as a drive-through. Fairgoers can drive to the fairgrounds where they'll be able to order the food. It'll be delivered to the car. The menu of all the food items and all the vendors are on the Facebook page, and those are so much fun to go through. You know, the funnel cakes, the fried pickles, they got, you know, the turkey legs wrapped in a woven bacon basket. You'll have to leave after getting your food. There's nowhere to sit and hang out, but they will do a drive-through food fair.
So they've removed all exercise from
it. Right.
Carney comes out. Yeah. Guesses your car's weight.
Before and after.
Yeah.
It's
amazing.
God, what a goddamn time we're living in. I never really cared about that.
I was just going to say we are so on our way to Wally. You're absolutely right.
We're on our way, guys.
Here's the list of just some of the things. I'll just pick some stuff out at random. You got your Italian sausages and you got your hot dogs, elephant ears, funnel cakes, you got your deep fried Oreos, your soft pretzels that are stuffed, fried cheese on a stick, smash burger, Dr. Pepper, pulled pork, beef patties. Wow. You know, out here they do the deep fried Slim Fast bars and they do the caviar Twinkies out here as well.
Really? What's that one?
I had it because when on Mark in the Morning, we used to do the LA County Fair. And so, of course, we had to be filmed eating everything. And it's like a split Twinkie with literally just globs of caviar, like globbed in it like a hot dog.
What is happening?
Because why happening? Not? Yeah, because there's nothing left to think of, apparently.
I haven't said this in a while, but this is why the terrorists hate us. And they're right.
Yeah.
We've crossed the line, right. Clearly.
They're right.
All right. You have Good Morning America on there, Max Zapata, with Stephanopoulos talking to Biden. I think he brings up this thing.
I do want to ask you about Michael Flynn. The president said yesterday that that move is justified because President Obama targeted Flynn. He called it, quote, the biggest political crime in U.S. history. Your former Senate colleague, Charles Grassley, has added that Flynn was entrapped. So what did you know about those moves to investigate Michael Flynn? And was there anything improper done?
I know nothing about those moves to investigate Michael Flynn, number one. Number two,
I do want to press that. You say you didn't know anything about it, but you were reported to be at a January 5th, 2017 meeting where you and the president were briefed on the FBI's plan to question Michael Flynn.
Oh, I thought you asked me whether or not I had anything to do with him being prosecuted.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I was aware that they asked for an investigation, but that's all I know about it. I don't know the detail of where we are right now. Focus on what's in front of us. All you right, have plenty of time to investigate.
So he had this weird reaction where he repeated the question back to him and then said, I didn't hear it right, which could be his age. But he also had a thing where he wanted to get away from that question or that allegation. So we'll see if it Bidengate. All right, let me hit Simply Safe, and that wasn't the way it looked when I saw it on Good Morning, whatever. That was like a whacked up probably internet version of it. Simply Safe, with all the uncertainty in the world, feeling safe at home has never been more important. That's why we need Simply Safe, comprehensive protection for your home. Longtime friends of the show. Oh, yeah, we've been doing business with these guys for a long time. You just order online, set it up yourself in under an hour. No technician or salesperson has to come to your home. Super important these days. No outrageous monthly fees. Your home is protected 24/7 with emergency dispatch for break-ins, fire, and more. All for just 50 cents a day. U.S. News and World Report named Simply Safe best overall home security for 2020, everybody. Great company, great product. Peel and stick. Batteries last up to 10 years. No drilling holes. No pulling wires. It's Simply Safe, right, Dawson?
Head to simplysafe.com/Adam and get a free HD camera for our listeners. That's simplysafe.com/Adam to make sure they know that our show sent you. From Simply Safe and all of us here, wishing you a safety and good health.
Oh, you know, I know what I wanted to say. It reminded me, thinking about Simply Safe. With all the people locked up at home drinking and doing other things that are bad for them, shouldn't we have more home fires? Remember when houses used to burn down? People would fall asleep smoking. Like, they just get drunk and fall asleep smoking. Think how much safer homes are now. You don't hear about home fires. Like, when I was when I was a kid, every fifth house burned down, like, on the block. Like, what happened? The guy fell asleep. He was smoking.
These days, it's exclusively reserved for deep-fried turkeys at Thanksgiving.
Yeah. Right. And
shady
you
businesses.
Don't smell, you don't smell the house fires like you used to. When you go out, there was a lot of house fires. That's really interesting.
Yeah.
It must have been the way they were built, right?
It had to do with, it's one of those things where it's like technology saves a lot, like smoke detectors and materials, you know, sofas that don't go up in a ball of flames, or flame retardant, you know, bedding or whatever it is. Like, all the technology has sort of made a difference. And it was
like, you can't steal car radios anymore. There's no stealing car radios. That doesn't happen.
I know.
That's right. Nobody wants it.
It was a world of people and you know, less people smoke. Although I do like, there's two guys I like, I think I could hang with. There's the guy who falls asleep while driving, which is an interesting chap, because it's like, I'm driving a motor vehicle and I'm going to bed. That's interesting to me. And also the guy who falls asleep while smoking. Like, I think I could smoke in my sleep. Like,
Well, Tim Conway Jr. has a great story about when he wasn't doing so well and he was living in Koreatown and doing the show, you know, where you did over in Koreatown. And he had inflatable furniture because that's all he could afford. And he fell asleep smoking on his inflatable couch and popped it.
It's a good fail safe, man.
That's real good.
I've had to pull over many a times while I was driving from almost falling asleep. So I'm trying to figure out what this makes me. I am
responsible.
Everyone is like, it's the same as everyone's been drunk. It's the difference between drunk driving and being drunk at a party and going, I'm going to lay down.
Oh, no, I'm talking totally sober. I get exhausted.
No, I know, but I'm saying, I'm not judging. If you're driving and you're tired and you go, I got to pull over to a rest stop, so be it. God. Yeah. All right. Sorry. What else, Gina?
So no one knows if or when the NHL is going to return, but if it does, fans can expect a lot of changes. Deputy Commissioner Bill Daly says infectious disease experts made some recommendations, and the league is considering everything that will cause modifications to the game in order to keep players safe, in order to even play at all. Here are some of the changes that we may have to get used to. And this is specifically to avoid contracting a virus. No fighting or scrums after the whistle. They don't want you locking horns. No spitting on the ice. Players must wear full face shields. Opposing players must stand farther apart on faceoffs, and all coaches on the bench must wear a mask.
What is full face shields? Like, are those face shields going all the way down?
Mm-hmm. I would imagine, any protective layer, you know, not plexiglass, but whatever that film is.
Yeah, the ones they have now, I believe, just for their eyes, they bring it all the way down.
Right.
Yeah. But see, I'm
Stormtrooper style.
I'm saying is you will steam that shit up lickety split. Like, there needs to be some way for you not to steam that up.
That's a good point.
They were
if they If they figured it out for space suits, I'm sure they can figure it out for NHL hockey masks.
Yeah.
A little different of a mission, but sure.
It's not what I'm saying. If the technology exists.
Yeah, it's true. But like in that, they're breathing oxygen that is being like that part of their contraption. You know, like, I don't know. It'll be.
They're exhaling carbon dioxide just like everyone else.
Yeah, but they're wearing 80 pounds of equipment too that is like scrubbing things and pulling things out. And they like. There's stuff they're wearing stuff that's
I see what you're saying.
They're wearing stuff to stop them to do that. This is just a piece of, well, I don't know what it is. So I'll have to see what it is.
There's a shield. We're
right. I'm looking at it, which means it has big holes in the bottom of it for your mouth. So you don't
that's
fog
not gonna
it up.
Fly.
But how does that work?
It's not going to fly.
Exactly the opposite. Got to get that mouth covered.
Chris is showing us this thing, but
yeah,
it's like.
These are what all the articles are putting up as their cover photo for. Oh.
Those holes are there for a reason, right? So it doesn't steam up. Isn't that
yeah,
the point?
But that's exactly the part you're trying to cover.
I've not measured a coronavirus, but I feel like it could make it through that 2-inch hole. I think. I'm not a scientist. Not Dr. Fauci.
Through the one hole.
Yeah. You're not a doctor.
I will tell you this about the NHL. They were way ahead of their time with that 6-foot-high plexi going all the way around.
Yep.
Around the thing. And if any good from this whole coronavirus thing, if any good comes from this, it could mean that we reinstate that weird plexi sneeze guard around all the drum kits from the 80s and 90s.
Oh, yeah.
Remember Arsenio's band? Like any house band had that weird plexi drum kit, which is somehow unnecessary now. It was an imperative in 1991, and now we don't need it. But Dawson will tell us why. I think I talked to Dawson about that plexi kit, which is you keeping the drum sound contained.
It keeps the drum sound contained so it doesn't bleed into other microphones.
Why don't we need it anymore? Because the monitors are better? The people who are wearing the ear
microphones have generally gotten better.
Oh, that's it. Right.
But they are still heavily used.
Are they?
On stage, yeah.
I don't feel like I see them nearly as much as I used to see them.
Usually on very large concerts when there is a huge array of speakers and a huge array of monitors and they really need to keep the stuff isolated, but not in smaller things. But you'll see on the big what was the most recent. There was like another almost worldwide concert a few months ago. Gina, am I crazy? There was something.
Was it for, I don't know if it was for a few months ago, but was it for
the Australian?
Like Las Vegas? Or was it for Australia?
It could have been either of those, but I remember seeing one on stage.
Has this whole thing has fucked up my whole timeline? I keep asking like, what? When's summer? What's going on? Or where's school? Or how old am I? And I had this discussion with Lynch the other day. I was like, wait a minute, do we have the Oscars? When are the Oscars? Do we have the Oscars? Who's doing the Oscars? Yeah. Like, what channel's the Oscars on? We were both sitting there kind of going, I wrote on the Oscars for 2 years. I was trying to figure out whether we had the Oscars or not. It's a weird, whole thing has fucked up my whole sort of timeline sequence memory.
It's called temporal disintegration.
Oh, that's what it is.
And everyone is, it's very real. People just don't know what day it is. And I know that this is a super morbid thing to say, so I'm sorry to bring it up, but I was thinking about this last night in terms of concerts and arena shows and things like that. We already were kind of not sold on these things because we were having active shooters every 6 months and crowds were being obliterated by crazy people and evil people, and people were shying away from going to concerts anyway. And now they're saying, well, guess what? There will be no giant public gatherings for what? A year and a half? Are people, between all this mayhem, are people ever going to want to go to a concert again?
I don't know, but there's two schools of thought. Are people going to be too scared to enter restaurants or venues or whatever that is? And there's a definite school of thought where you go, oh yeah, people are going to be freaked out. My impulse has always been, we're kind of American and we want to get back to everything, or there's going to be enough people to fill the venue who at least think that way. And I talked to somebody who said somebody just went rogue and reopened a restaurant in Orange County or something.
Colorado.
A
few of them. Yeah. And the answer is like, we're sold out of food. We got to run. Like people, now that's one. So who the hell knows? But My general take is people will come back. Maybe it's different people. I don't know.
Yeah. And we may have talked about it on this show, but some of the new protocols at restaurants, and it'll sure change the fancy restaurants, the highfalutin restaurants, but they don't want tablecloths on tables. They don't want salt and pepper shakers, paper menus that can be thrown away immediately. So I don't know what's going to happen to the Michelin restaurants, but they really don't want these trappings that can literally trap viruses.
And I don't know how I've been investigating a little bit. When I found out that they're going to start to reopen some of the restaurants, like, what does that mean? How far? What are the rules? All that stuff, at least in Los Angeles, is like going, or California is going down now. So we don't know, but we're going to find out.
Plexiglass.
Soon.
It's going to be who's ever manufacturing plexiglass right now is making a killing, because it's going to be everywhere.
Maybe you got to find, Chris, from Get Smart, which I brought up earlier in the week, the cone of silence. Maybe it's time for the cone of silence. You guys remember the cone of silence?
Yep. Yep. No.
It was a really funny thing, which is on Get Smart, when Max Smart had to talk to the chief about something sensitive, he'd go, "We got to use the cone of silence." And the chief would always go, "It never works. It never works." And he'd go, no, we're going to use the cone of silence." It was really, to me, it's the modern version of Skype. You know, when we do a live show and you go, "You want David Alan Greer to Skype in?" It's like, "It won't work. It'll never work. It never works." But so Max would always go, we need to use the cone of silence. And they'd go, and the cone of silence, a big like plexi device or something, would call in their head, and they couldn't hear each other. Play the cone of silence. It'll make me laugh. You guys should watch Get Smart. It's Buck Henry and Mel Brooks from way back in the day. Sorry.
Him talking on the shoe as a kid was like the greatest thing ever.
Go ahead, Max.
Oh, we got to reload it.
Oh, we got to reload it. Anyway.
Hey, in the meantime, Gina made me think of a version of Rich Man, Poor Man, which is the restaurants that use paper, like disposable menus.
Right.
That's the low-end places, of course, the taquerias and whatever. But like the really nice restaurants, they're making their menu day of with like fresh ingredients from the farmer's market and everything. So they're printed like that day. So it's a kind of a rich man, poor man thing with restaurants.
Paper menu. Yeah. Good.
On the parchment paper.
Here comes the cone of silence. Sorry.
Well, then shouldn't we? Do you want me to leave the room?
That won't be necessary, Hodgkins. We can talk under the cone of silence.
The cone of silence?
Well, this is a magenta alert, isn't it?
The cone of silence.
The giant plexi bubble that goes.
I am deeply concerned about the conference room.
How loud it is.
What? I'm concerned about the conference room.
How's that?
He's concerned about the conference room.
He's outside.
I want it thoroughly inspected for hidden devices, microphones, bombs.
What?
Check for microphones and bombs.
Oh. Well, do you really think that's necessary, Chief? I mean, isn't that an anti-infiltration tactic?
What?
He wonders if that's an anti-infiltration tactic.
You get the joke. It's very Mel Brooks, Buck Henry. It's funny. That show holds up, the cone of silence. It was always funny because it never worked, and you always knew what the joke was. But it was
and
always...
the true gem is he asked if he should leave the room, and he's the one telling that.
Interpreting.
Yes, what makes that funny is the guy outside acting as an interpreter, obviously. The cone of silence, Gina. There you go.
There it is. Done. There are these glass booths at this Dutch restaurant that are really, really beautiful. Where they're trying out that kind of move, where it's like these little A-frame glass booths that you can sit in, you know, to sort of keep your germs away from everyone else. But they look awesome, so maybe people will do that.
And there's also going to be some story of somebody having their life saved by eating on the other side of the plexi, whatever. A car ran off the road, hit a thing. The fire hydrant was flying right at the person's head, but was deflected by the... Like, there's going to be a bunch of those, right? There's going to be some tragic ones. There's going to be some good ones. There's going to be some weird ones where, like, a bird flies into one and it's all on film. Like, there's going to be... some plexi-related protective distance. There's going to be a safe distancing thing where the tables are 8 feet apart and a van's emergency brake comes off and it rolls right through where the table where they would have been. Like, there's going to be it's going to be a lot of that, right? It's going to be those are going to be the next gen of stories.
Not about a lot, but that will happen. It certainly will happen.
I got to tell you, with the amount of safety, whatever issues. Oh, if it becomes a theme in the news, they'll be looking for it. And there's surveillance cameras everywhere now. There's just going to be a bunch of weird stuff, unintended, sort of happy circumstances. Theo, are those your kids in the background? What am I hearing?
They just got in. They went to see the Blue Angels fly over. The Jets flew over today. Yeah. Pretty amped up from seeing these fighter jets fly over.
Yeah, they're coming here soon too.
Are they?
I can give you the date. Hold on.
I love it.
Doing a flyover.
Yeah.
They could be, I think it's pretty quick, right? Because they get from here to San Antonio quickly. And then I don't know how long do they fly without refueling?
I don't know their equipment exactly, but their range should be. God, those, I don't know, F-18 Hornets or Super Hornets or Marine Hornets or something, F-16s. I don't know what those things are. They should be able to do it. They should have that range for sure. Planes got to have 600 miles, 6,000, they got to have 2,000 miles of range. I mean, for sure.
And they fuel up in the air. They could fuel up in the air. Am I correct?
They could. I don't think they would.
Got it.
They'd stop somewhere and refuel if they had to. But I don't know. What do they fly? A Hornet? Max Battle. Look at Blue Angels.
This says they're going to be flying over L.A. Friday.
I have the flyover will involve 6 F-16C Fighting Falcons.
Fighting Falcons. Let's see if you can find the range of a Fighting Falcon. I want to go up in one of those things. That sounds awesome. I want to see the new Top Gun, by the way. When the hell?
Me too.
Postponed. Let me double check that.
Oh, it's definitely postponed. But is it postponed like Fast and Furious where they went like, well, we'll go 16 months. Like they literally.
I think it's on the same calendar. I think they did that.
Seeing December 23rd. Let me verify.
Okay. And how are they deciding? Like I was.
December 23rd.
I was talking to,
it was going to be up June 24th and they pushed it, I guess, 6 months.
Yeah. So I was talking to Judd Apatow about the King of Staten Island, the Pete Davidson movie and like
June.
Right. But it's now online, right? Or has that been working, I guess?
The Trolls my kids, that Trolls movie, you know, they only give it to you for like 48 hours and it's like $20 and it made over a couple of hundred million. So
really?
It works. Yeah, it works. I mean, but then again, that's a kid's animated film.
Yeah. I would imagine kids' movies are very well set up for this model because you'll pay anything to keep your kids quiet for a couple of days.
That's what we did with Onward. When Onward became available, we got it the first night.
And we saw that was the last movie we took the kids to see in the theater. And the second it came up, we did the same thing and we bought it. I think for kids' movies, it might be a little different. But I think, I mean, you know, kind of everybody's seen this coming as the TVs get bigger and less expensive. And, you know, I always thought it should be available in both. You should give people the choice. I think that would be kind of a better move. And I think that's probably what's going to happen. It's like the larger ones.
Can you see a movie in Houston or Austin in a movie theater these days?
I think you can.
Adam's weekend is getting packed.
Yeah, I think
you're not going to have time to do a show.
Yeah, especially at the dine-in theaters. I think they'd separate. That's what happened with us. So I think they're back to that. You can go see a movie.
Gina, you and I are going to host these shows.
Yeah, he's never coming back.
We sure wish Adam showed up tonight, but
in the white pants with no shirt on, seeing whatever movie's out. By the way, who knows what's
out? Yeah, like good news, the theater's open. Bad news, we're showing Aloha, Bobby and Rose from 1977.
And you go, I'll take it. Bring me the popcorn and the raisinets. I don't care.
F-16 range, 2,622. So it's got the range. Maxim speed's 1,500 miles an hour. Well, you're going to burn a lot of fuel at that rate. But, yeah, the range is almost cross-country. That's a good guess. I'll take it.
Well,
all right, let's bring it home, Gina Grad.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
Gina Grad.
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Max Pata, see what movies are playing in Houston. This movie thing is on the table. And see if I can watch a movie, get my hair cut in the theater, and eat barbecue while getting my eyebrows waxed.
This is going to be quite the montage.
Let's see if we can work that one out. But are there theaters open in the Houston area? And then you would just go in and sit three seats apart?
I'm looking at Fandango.com here, and it does not seem like there's any movie theaters open in Houston.
What about the Alamo? Wow. Isn't there a draft house there?
Well, Alamo's closed for sure. The only twist out
Drive-ins.
Movie's being released. So it's something you're gonna want to see.
Right. Right.
Well, they're showing old, like the one over here, the dine-in one, they do every week, they do like the Goonies and like the Outsiders, and they'll show the old movies. So yeah. No, this is went back before this in the regular theaters. They're showing. Yeah. They were showing like Purple Rain right before. They show movies.
All right,
see something.
Let me hit Geico real quick there. Geico, they are sharing, and you're sharing, and thanks for sharing what you know online and doing all your fun DIY haircuts and everything else. Geico is going to share too. They'll give you back 15% credit on your car and motorcycle policies for current and new customers, because Geico's committed to the long haul, and they realize you're not driving nearly as much as you used to or out on your motorcycle quite as much, although I've seen people out on their motorcycles, but they're definitely driving less. So 15% credit lasts the full policy term. Visit geico.com/giveback for info and eligibility. geico.com/giveback. Good Sports is coming up, and like I said, doing a benefit show, Houston Improv. So come on out May 21st, 22nd, 23rd. And all the money's going to the Houston Food Bank over there. But come on out to the theater. You can check out my stand-up on our YouTube channel. And I'm your emotional support animal. Available for pre-order, coming out soon. Theo Rossi. Theory with Theo Rossi. New episodes every week on Apple Podcasts, Podcast One, and Spotify as well. Thanks, Theo.
Thank you guys so much. I appreciate you. Have fun with no shirt on and white flare pants.
Thank you. So, until next time, Adam Kroll with Theo Rossi and Gina Grad and Paul Bryan. Say it. Mahalo.
Stick around. Dave Dameshek and Adam Carolla return for Good Sports right after this. Thank you, guys.
Bye.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, guys. Have a good night.
You too. Follow the Adam Carolla Show on Twitter at Adam Carolla Show. Follow Ace on Twitter at Adam Carolla. You can leave us a voicemail at 888-634-1744. Pre-order Adam's book. It's out next month. It's called I'm Your Emotional Support Animal. And you can pre-order it at adamcarolla.com.